In this video, I'm spending 100 days in Pixelmon. My goals are to become a Pokemon legend by catching and training a full Dark-type team, annihilating the most evil trainer in the world, catching a legendary Pokemon, and creating the ultimate secret treehouse base. Make sure to grab some snacks because you are in for a wild ride. Loading into our single-player world, we had a huge mixture of Pokemon to choose from. Unfortunately, there were no Dark-type Pokemon, so I went for Litten because he looks kind of evil. Straight away, we're greeted by a beautiful Christmas tree, and I just had to stop and admire the landscape. There are a few candy canes dotted around, a ravine, and a floating house? That's gonna be very interesting to check out later. I then decided it was time to get started. I saw this huge Golurk protecting the Pokeshop, but he wasn't very good at his job, because I just walked straight past him. Heading upstairs, I found my first stash of goodies. A ton of potions and Pokeballs. This wasn't all though, because there was even more. I then turned on this TV to see SpongeBob. After this, I looted a few more houses and found this villager literally inside the ceiling. She was vibing though, so I decided to let her be. The Christmas tree then caught my eye again, so I decided to open a few presents. To my surprise, there was some great loot here. Unfortunately, the Christmas Pokeballs weren't that great, but they were free and I love free. I then came across a Zigzagoon and knew it was time to put my Litten to the test. I used Scratch and knocked his HP down halfway. He didn't even damage my Litten. I used Ember and put him in his place once and for all. This victory was a start of something great. I also found some iron, aluminum, and armor in a house and yoinked it all. It was time to check out that floating house though. It was very intriguing. After committing a mild act of deforestation, I started heading up. Little did I know, this was about to be insanely overpowered. Upon walking inside, I realized it was Santa's workshop. It was probably not very good of me to steal this bike, and some stuff from the chests, and this Pikachu mug. But surely I'm still on Santa's good list. I tried to ask him, but he was more concerned about the mess of the workshop. Now that I had this bike though, I could go traveling, and that's exactly what I did. A Galastria then spawned right in front of me, but I couldn't really do much because he was such a high level. I tried to test my luck with a few Pokeballs, but ultimately Galastria was victorious. Next time maybe. Just then though, I saw Mareep and threw out Litten. I used Ember and tried to catch her. I caught her on my first try, but it was finally turning night, so I put my bed down and dozed off to sleep. Bright and early on day two, I hopped on my bike and came across my first Pokestop. It gave me a few cool items, but nothing crazy. There were also two barrels I was able to loot with a ton of potions and safari Pokeballs. I may need these later. After battling a few Pokemon and getting my Litten to level 8, I started to look for a plains biome to try and test my luck. I knew a few dark Pokemon, like Umbreon, spawns here at night, so I set up a little temporary base while I waited. Unfortunately though, it was in vain, as no dark type Pokemon spawned, so after sleeping the rest of the night away, I packed up and left. I was still motivated though, because I knew it was only a matter of time before I caught my first dark Pokemon. On my quest to find a village, I came across a ruined portal which had 3 obsidian in the chest. I hoped it would be enough to complete it, but it was still one short, so I continued on my way. Shortly after, I crossed over a river and finally found a village. This would hopefully give me everything I needed to catch a dark Pokemon when I found one. I went through and borrowed some potions, Pokeballs, and food from the villagers. I now have over 20 Ultra Balls, which is insane this early on. I thought about setting up base here, but decided it was too rural and wanted to go for somewhere closer to a plains biome so I could catch some better Pokemon. I kept exploring, going through a seasonal forest and then a dark forest. Somehow, I came across another village. However, this one had a gym in it. There were also some gigantic mountains that looked like the Farlands. I noted the cords down in case I needed to go there later for Pokemon. I then found some Poke loot on the floor and got a light ball. Nothing crazy, but free is free. The sun was now setting, which is the perfect time to go out and look for Pokemon. I rode around, found a cool coral in the river nearby, and finally, I found my first dark Pokemon, and it was Umbreon. I was ecstatic. I even have a custom coffee cup of Umbreon, so he would be a perfect candidate for our team. All I had to do was catch him, which is a little bit more difficult than it seemed. I tried to catch him with an Ultra Ball, but he broke free. So I threw another, and another, and many, many more times, until finally, on my 7th try, I caught him. I was so happy to finally have our first dark Pokemon, and leveled him up with all my rare candies from my pillaging adventures. I then replaced Helping Hand and replaced it with Mean Look, so Pokemon couldn't run away during battles. Now that I had Umbreon, my bike was kinda useless, but I kept it anyway. Instead of sleeping the night away, I celebrated my victory by destroying a few Pokemon right into day 3. For almost the entirety of day 4, I traveled the world searching for the perfect place to call home. That was until I came across this village. It was perfect. The area looked amazing, the houses were beautiful, and there were tons of loot for us to acquire. At first, my plan was to build a wall around the village or take over one of the houses, but when I saw this thick boy of a tree, I knew what I had to do. I crafted up some ladders for our new starter tree house. This wasn't going to be any tree base though, because we were going to live inside of it, completely secret. I carved out the inside of the tree and modeled the inside. This wasn't going to be my base forever, but it would do for now. Finally, I rested the night away. Day 5 has come around super fast, so it was time to make some big progress. I did some more house modeling, and right as I left my base, I saw Panita. Before I had any chance to admire him though, he jumped my Umbreon, so I used Assurance and one-shot him. After, I worked on my tree base some more and started a mine. Almost right away, I fell into a cave, which normally would be terrible, but this was a blessing. A ghastly was standing right there, just chilling, waiting to be captured. I jumped into battle with him and tossed an Ultra Ball. Just like that, we had another dark Pokemon. Our team is finally coming together. This little endeavor took us into the night, so I went back up to land and slept. On the morning of day 6, I threw out my new ghastly to admire him. He was a very low level, but we were gonna level him up soon. Somehow though, I went this long without an iron pickaxe, so I made one. Just then though, I came across a Starly. Even though he wasn't a dark type, he was just too cute not to catch. I threw him out and admired how his eyes stared directly into your soul. I then looked up and a Pidgeotto was flying overhead, so I began to chase him down. I went deep into the desert, but eventually he was victorious. He was just too fast. I needed a flying type Pokemon to be able to chase him down. After riding my Umbreon back to base, I then decided to loot the rest of the village because I wanted some items to help level up my Pokemon. There was a lot of stuff here, but I didn't need any of it. However, I did find this Dark Gem, which I was pretty happy about. I gave it to Umbreon. I ransacked the village some more, making my Pokemon a little more overpowered with some power-ups. It started to go nighttime, so I ran back to my little treehouse and fell asleep. Afterwards, I left my base and saw a giraffe rig. She looks super cool, but she wasn't a dark type, so sorry, giraffe rig. I then hopped on my Umbreon and started a little adventure. I found another ruined portal which had an obsidian and some fire gems. I left the gems as I wouldn't be needing any fire type Pokemon in these 100 days. I wanted some more iron, so after crafting some torches, I went back to my mine. That's when I came across this really creepy offworm. I didn't want this dude slithering up to my treehouse and eating my Pokemon while I slept, so Umbreon 2 shot him with Assurance and Moonlight. I then mined a bunch of iron and began to smelt it all up. At this point, I decided it was time to take my team to the next level. So I began looking for a lava lake. I crossed the desert, took some water from this lake, and found one in this savanna biome. I began construction on my nether portal by using the tried and true speedrunner method, although this did take me about 10 minutes. And after finally completing it, I hopped in, and just like that, I'm officially ready to go searching for some new team members. I traversed the harsh landscape of the nether over the next day and came across so many ghastlies. But finally, I had found a Houndour, which would be the next member of our team. I chucked a few Pokeballs and caught him on my sixth try. I didn't really want to stay in the nether for much longer, so I decided to head back to my portal. My team was already looking pretty stacked. With Umbreon, Ghastly, and Houndour, I was super stoked with how these 8 days have gone, and it was time to start day 9. My team hasn't got into any big confrontations yet, so I hadn't really needed to use a Poke Healer much. However, I decided to head to the village and pick one up. This village didn't have a Pokestop or anything. However, inside the basement of these two wonderful villagers, there was a pink PC and a healing machine. I managed to pick up the PC, but upon mining the healer, it unfortunately broke. I guess I needed to craft one instead. I went back to our treehouse, stashed the goodies, and placed down our new PC. I put our non-dark type Pokemon inside to make room for the rest of our team while we find them. Now though, I was finally ready to level up the team I had. I went out and spent the next several days just farming Pokemon non-stop. My Ghastly evolved into Haunter on day 15, which I could now ride. I then continued to battle Pokemon until day 19. And would you look at that, another dark type Pokemon. I jumped into battle with Puccina and started throwing balls straight away. It took a bit to catch her, but I didn't mind because I love throwing balls. Afterwards, I raided another village, taking a nice green PC and chair. Until finally, following the last few battles, I came across a Zoroark. I threw everything I had at him until I captured him in one of my balls. On the daybreak of day 24, things were looking up, literally. I saw this huge boss Pokemon flying overhead. I ran straight after the boss for miles, but as a flying type, he was just too fast for me. I took out my frustration on this Spiro, but then felt kind of bad, so I decided to capture him. I also came across this super cute teddy bear Pokemon and a rabbit Pokemon. On my way home, I took out a Talo and Espa to get a little more XP for my Umbreon. I also got an Enderpearl, which is pretty sweet. When I got home, I put Spiro in my PC, deposited my goodies, and organized some furniture. And during the night, farmed up a bunch of sand. As I was heading back, a Monage jumped me and Zoroark. But thankfully, I once had 360 no-scoped him with Night Slash. I smelted up my glass, and that led us on to day 25. I made some glass panes, grabbed some red dye, and made them red. I wasn't going to use them just yet, though. I then left my base because I wanted to check out the training area in the village. There were three villagers. One level 30, one 40, and the last one 50. I would soon come to know that the level 51's name is Alex. However, I decided to take on the level 30 lad in a kilt. He had a level 30 Raticate, and used Quick Attack on a Zoroark. I then used Night Slash, getting him down to 13% HP. I could basically pinch him and his Pokemon would go down. I used Night Slash again, and he fainted. Then he pulled out a Carbink, who actually decimated my Zoroark in one shot. So I sent out Haunter to tilt the battle back into my favor. Haunter one-shot Carbink with Hex, and next Ekans was sent out. He couldn't do anything though, and just got destroyed by Hex as well. Meowth was sent out next, and he took a big chunk of Haunter's health. He kept using Knockoff, which was just deflecting Haunter's Hex attack, so I used Sucker Punch. Then I used Hex on his Flaffy. For his final Pokemon, he threw out a Herdia, but it didn't stand a chance against a Sucker Punch straight to his face. I won the battle and got 12 Pokédollars. This was a very bad bet. In fact, why are we betting Pokédollars while we're battling Pokemon? So much is wrong with this world. After this, I didn't want to waste my time with the level 40 trainer, so I decided to go straight for the level 50 named Alex. Espeon was first up. Umbreon used Assurance and sent him straight to the back rooms. Tauros was sent out next. I used Assurance again and got him down to 14% HP. Alex used Mega Horn though, and it really hurt my Umbreon. Thankfully, his Pokemon fainted after his go. Alex then sent out a very handsome Rapidash. It looked very, very intimidating and knocked out my Umbreon with Play Rough instantly. I hadn't healed my Pokemon from before, so we were in for a tough battle. I threw out my Haunter again and one-shot Rapidash and Crobat. Next up was my Nectric. I used Sucker Punch and stuck him down to 23% HP. Unfortunately, my Haunter fainted, so I decided to forfeit the battle. I lost, but hey, maybe I would have won if I healed up my Pokemon? Trust me, I will get my revenge on Alex, even if it's the last thing I do. I did a little more decoration to my tree base and then slept the night away. We're now on day 26. I needed to work through some pent-up anger from losing to Alex, so I went to a raid I saw earlier. Unfortunately, there were no others to play with because I'm on single player, so I was just gonna do this solo. I would love to play with some of you guys one day, so leave a comment if you want me to make a server. I'm also on 1.6 thousand subscribers at the moment, so if you could subscribe, it would mean the world to me. Going into battle, I was fighting a Tyrant. With my Haunter, this would be insanely easy though. With two Hex hits, I had already knocked him out. I got a ton of presents, and even the opportunity to catch him. I threw out a Master Ball, but unfortunately, we weren't able to get him. I used my Dynamax candy on my Umbreon, of course, and I then come across this huge Beedrill boss. This dude is genuinely the scariest thing I've seen in my life. I was going to try and annihilate him, but then I realized he was level 130. Not today, Beedrill, not today. The village still had some loot, so I decided to take it back to my base. I looted the Pokeshop, took a TV, and then it came across a Shinx. This was an electric type Pokemon, but I still wanted to catch him because he was insanely cute. I threw a few Premier Balls, but decided to save them for later. After this, I went to my treehouse and slept the night. On day 27, I wanted to go on a huge mining run. I went straight down my mine, found a cave, and started mining out all the resources. I needed aluminum to make a Poke Healer, so I wouldn't have to keep going village to village. After collecting all the iron, I found a ravine with a mine shaft. I explored for a while until a Galvan Tuna tried to attack me. He was only level 36 though, so my Haunter one-shot him with Hex. I think he was protecting this chest, which actually had three pieces of aluminum inside of it, which is enough to craft our Poke Healer. This wasn't all though, because a few seconds later, after taking down Galvan Tuna, I found diamonds! It was only a one vein, but I will take it. After this, I went home and checked the crafting recipe to see what I actually needed. I had everything I needed inside the chest, so I grabbed it all, and finally, on day 27, I had crafted my first healing station. I placed it down right next to my chest and celebrated by doing a little remodeling. This led us on to day 28. I knew that I needed to find the sixth and final member of our team if I wanted to stand any chance of leveling them all up to max and beating stupid Alex. So I hopped on my Umbreon and started adventuring. I went through many, many biomes. times and came across huge herds of Pokemon. I also found this village, which, of course, I decided to borrow some loot from. Continuing my quest, I also went through Sierra Valley, which I thought looked pretty unique. After 2 days of exploring, I found nothing to catch, so I went to the Nether with the hope I would at least find something there. I was prepared to spend a very long time in the Nether because without my Sith Pokemon, my team would stand no chance against any big battles. Finally, some good luck! I had found a Nether Fortress. Unfortunately though, after scouring literally every single corner of it, there was nothing. No chests at all, so I had to continue traveling. After a day of riding, I came across this awesome Glowstone Gardens biome. I loved how it looked. This was also a huge blessing because right in front of it was the biggest bastion ever. Thankfully, there were no mobs from stopping me from entering, so I looted some chests on the outside and made my way to the middle. I did a little parkour, and the middle was absolutely loaded. 2 netherite ingots, an enchanted diamond chestplate, and a master ball? This had to have been the craziest chest in the game. I took it all and rushed back to my nether portal to get home. It was the night of day 32 when I got back, so I slept the night away to awake on day 33, where I decorated my little starter treehouse with gold blocks. I have to admit, I was looking pretty stacked. I wanted to fight some Pokemon, so I decided to do a raid nearby. I destroyed Tyrant in a few measly hits. I got some large XP candy too, so I'll take it. Following this win, I also embarked on the quest to find a new team member again. I found the village, and by the time the night hit, I was in the Tiger Mountains. A chat message had popped up saying that Yveltal had spawned, so I rushed about looking for him. And there he was, right next to a mountain. I ran straight over and went to fight him, but realized I could just throw my Master Ball. Obviously, I caught him on my first try and went crazy. We finally had our full team and a legendary. I sent out Yveltal and rode him for the first time. It took a bit to get used to, but thankfully, I had a water bucket to clutch. Before heading home though, I did a raid against a flying-type Pokemon. It was Hoot Hoot. Yveltal one-tapped him with Dark Pulse. He is insanely OP. On my way home, it was now day 34. I came across this super cool Magikarp build in the water, so I checked it out. Inside was a level 28 villager, so I decided to absolutely decimate him in a battle. Now, I'm entitled to all the amazing loot he had in his house. There was nothing too great, but there were some cool leggings that I took. Finally though, I made it close to home, where I water clutched so I could take on some raids. The first one was against Murkrow, who Yveltal hit with Dark Pulse, for another Pokemon to finish him off. The next one was against Wormadam, who we hit for 50% of his HP before using Dark Pulse to finish him off. I got some pretty sweet loot, but nothing crazy. Now though, I wanted to juice up my Pokemon a bit. They were lacking in the level department, so I commenced Operation Level 80. It was time to get them all to level 80 or more, so I battled on day 35, and on day 36, and on day 37. On 38 though, I decided to switch it up, so I did a raid on this super cool tower. This one was against Mighty Yenna. He was gigantic! I used Focus Blast and struck him for 50 HP. Yveltal then used Psychic, and just like that, the raid was over. I got 2 candies from this one, which was a huge help. During the rest of the day, I traveled around looking for something to do. That was until I came across this, an Ultra Space portal. It took me a while to get into it, but once I did, I got an achievement and started looking around. I had never been in Ultra Space before, and I was surprised there was no fog in the Ultra Jungle. I jumped along some treetops until something crazy happened. Necrozma spawned? I searched for him instantly and eventually found him. I started tossing balls like there was no tomorrow. It only took 3 Ultra Balls to catch him. Once I did, I did a little spin, and he was sent to my PC, so I looked for another portal to get back. It took until the morning of day 39, but I finally found one. After returning to my base, I instantly switched out Puccina for him. After some research, it turned out he was Psychic, but he had Night Slash, which is a Dark-type move, so I decided to keep him anyway. It was too good of a catch to pass up. I then went on a grinding spree and spent the next 10 and a half days doing battle after battle and raid after raid until finally, my Pokemon were all at least level 80, so it would be easier to get them to level 100 later. I finally wanted to start on my real secret treehouse base, so I spent day 50, 51, and 52 farming wood. On the night of day 52, it was time to start on the foundations. I wanted to make this tree a very thick boy, so I could have a pretty big treehouse. I made it about 6 blocks thick. I was building it all up all the way until the morning of day 53 and continue to do so until night. After it was about 25 blocks tall, I started working on the floor of the treehouse. I built a decent amount amount of it using slabs. By the morning, I had begun building the core of the treehouse and the top of the tree. I also spent a day farming leaves because I would need a lot to cover the top of the tree. Next, I began working on how we would actually get up the treehouse. I started making little slab platforms all the way up. For some reason, I did this on 3 hearts, which was pretty ballsy of me, I must admit. By the end of the day, I was about halfway done. While I was finishing up the staircase, I saw a boss Pokemon. This dude looked insane. It was Alakazam. He was level 130, but I just had to beat him. Alakazam was radiating a dark aura, but this didn't scare me or Yveltal. Alakazam used Disable, but it failed against my Yveltal. I then used Dark Pulse and knocked him down to 34% HP. He was getting destroyed. After this, I used Disable and then Dark Pulse. I thought this would take him down, but he was straggling on a measly 0.5% HP, so I finished him off with a Sky Attack. I got some amazing loot from this too, including a Keystone. After, I went back up to my treehouse to admire the circular sun before going to bed. The next day, I worked on placing some leaves at the top of my tree just to see what it would look like. This took way longer than I expected, but it was starting to look pretty awesome. I had used literally all of my iron apart from 6 to farm the leaves I would need for the rest of this tree. At long last, on the night of day 62, I took a step back to look at the base and it was looking crazy. Definitely not as good as those mega builds you see all over YouTube, but for an amateur builder, not bad at all. I then almost died clutching down, but thankfully survived to live another day. It was time to start working on the inside of the treehouse, so after moving some of the loot to the chests, I placed a few stability beams around and started to fill the roof with slabs. I then decided I didn't really like the slabs though, so I removed them throughout the night. I then filled in the walls and placed a few windows to let in some natural light. Real estate prices are all about the natural lighting. I then started to build a little prison for Pokemon hidden by leaves, but my lawyer instructed me it was a very bad idea, so I decided it would be my bedroom. This room looks super awesome once all the lighting was up. During the night, I started moving all the stuff into my treehouse, starting with a beautiful pile of gold, the gaming and healing corner, and finally my bedroom. Once I put my bed down, I slept the rest of the night away. While I was transferring loot, I came across another boss Pokemon. It was Alakazam again. This time I would be putting my Umbreon to the test. He actually turned out to be insanely OP and literally one-shot a level 130 boss Pokemon at level 82. I then saw this cute Swordsbuck who looked like he was gonna pick a fight, but then decided to run away. Eventually, I was finished. Everything was in our new base, including these sweet vending machines, and so it was time to start a new quest in the morning. It was now day 67. There was only 33 days left, so I needed to start leveling up my Pokemon and evolving them to max levels. I started doing a raid against Mr. Mime. This Pokemon was one of the creepiest dudes I have ever seen, and I wanted to burn it with fire, but unfortunately I couldn't, so I used Assurance and one-shot him to get some Dynamax candy. I then fattened up Umbreon a bit with the candy. After this raid, I then found another one against Tyrant, who once again got one-shot by Assurance. I was starting to think my Pokemon could beat anything. I then spent the next several days battling, adventuring, committing robbery, and water bucket clutching. I saw this raid with Panita, so I decided to fight it. The raid started off pretty slow with Panita using a mysterious barrier, but once it ran out, Necrozma used Night Slash, and I used the rare candy I got on him. I ran through this Galuna clearing on the same day, and thought it looked super nice. I might have to set up a base here in a future 100 days. I flew across the ocean for a bit and came across a Huntail raid. Dynamax energy gathered around me and I was prepared to destroy him. I managed to use Night Slash, but once again, the boss cheated and used a mysterious barrier. It wasn't enough to protect her for long though, because she got knocked out by literally all of us using our attacks at the same time. On day 88, I was finally finished. Or well, almost. My Zoroark was level 99, but I had literally been playing for 6 hours straight, so I wanted to do something new. I decided to jump into an ultra space portal, which might not have been the best idea at night, but it would be morning soon anyway. The first Pokemon I ran into was Munna. I wanted to try out my new Dynamax band, so I used Max Darkness and sent him to the Shadow Dimension. Next, I decided to use my Zoroark on Hoot Hoot. I needed to finally level him up to level 100. It turned out he had a few friends though, so it was time to annihilate them all. I started by using Max Darkness on Rowlet, then Umbreon used Dark Pulse to finish off Sudowoodo. After, I destroyed Hoot Hoot and the level 70 Mashana, and finally Munna. This battle got my Zoroark super close to level 100. The next Pokemon I battled was Sork. I pretty much knocked them all out with Yveltal, and after my Zoroark finally leveled up, every one of my Pokemon were now max level, which was awesome. Maybe we could finally beat Alex. I stayed in Ultra Space for a while longer until finally all my Pokemon fainted and I spawned back in my bed. It took a few days though, but I was super happy with how it went. It was now day 74 and I really wanted to do some work work on my house and finally beat the most evil trainer in the game. I depoted all my loot and traveled to the nearest villages. I took a lot of gems to stockpile, a nice dark blue bed, some carpet, tons of barrels, a fridge, and a few other bits and bobs for the next day. Afterwards, I flew back on my Necrozma and decorated the house. I started with the blue beds and the Pokemon mug, placed down some carpet to make it way more cozy and homely. Then I placed my fridge and two plants. I loved how this looked so much. I then slept the night away, and on day 96, I wanted to do something important, so I went to find Alex. I kinda wanted to take Alex as a pet, but he wasn't a Pokemon, so I resorted to other measures. Firstly, I tried water, and it worked pretty well, but I couldn't get him away fast enough. I also couldn't get him up blocks. It took me ages just to get him even a pinch closer to my base, but then I did some research and found out you can use fishing rods. I almost died bringing Alex up my staircase, but it was worth it. After this, I began looking for a way to adopt him, until I had the perfect idea. I made a little hole inside the tree, placed a platform, and then placed iron bars for aesthetics. I thought it looked super homely. Finally, I went to bed and awoke on day 100. It was finally time to end our revenge arc and beat Alex. I threw out my Umbreon and instantly activated my Dynamax. He was going to use Espeon. Umbreon used Mac Darkness and one-shot Espeon. Tauros was up next. I decided to switch to Necrozma, and Tauros attacking me had actually taken some of his own HP. Of course, one of the most powerful Pokemon in existence just one-shot him. I used Psy Shock against Manectric. Rapidash was too cute of a Pokemon to destroy with Necrozma, so I switched him out for Houndoom to make it a little bit more fair. I used Inferno for some reason, and obviously it did nothing. It was all a part of the plan, I swear. After, I destroyed him with Foul Play. Crobat then went down to Foul Play as well. For his final Pokemon Stoutland, Yveetle used Acrobatics. And just like that, Alex was mine. Little did he know, I would become a Pokemon legend and come back to defeat him. I then checked out the base one last time with Umbreon and rode him as one last goodbye. He was my first dark type Pokemon in these 100 days. It's been a crazy journey. If you've somehow watched this far, you're probably my FBI agent, so hi. If not, leave a comment and I'll do another 100 days video this month. Love you all. Have a fantastic day.